At 5, we're going to set that to 1. So again, we're not setting, so 5 is 1 plus 2, sorry, 1 plus 4. We're not going to set bits 1 and 4. We're going to set just this one single bit. Yeah. X is the object that we're inserting into the loop.
So,
is yeah, so think of this, so if we're inserting Alice, Bob, Carol, and Dave, this would, let's say Alan, it might be Alice. Hash the string Alice. Once, using one function, we get 13. We pick a different hash function, hash it, and we get 2. We pick a different hash function, we hash Alice, we get 5. So again, every one of these hash functions is not identifying a set of bits, but it's telling us, it's pointing at 3 specific bits in the bit vector. But X is the object that we're inserting. Does that address your question?
So we look like every bit.
Yes, so we repeat this process for every element.
In fact,
more precise example. So I have, just for preciseness, I've reduced the size of the bit vector to 8. So I've got 8 bits, and I'm setting 3 of them for each object. So my first key gives me, the first hash function gives me a 3, the second hash function gives me a 2, then 4, then 6. 1, then 6, then 7. Sorry, 1, then 5, then 6. 0 base to 8. Yeah. So these are 2 parameters. The number of bits and the number of hash functions are configurable parameters, and we'll get to how those get defined in 3 or 4 slides. I just want to get across the basic function, the way that the bit that loop filter works before we get into the configuration. Is that correct? It doesn't address your question, but does that satisfy you for now? Okay, so we're going to create a bloom filter. We take the things that we want to put into the bloom filter, and we basically do a bitwise OR on the bits that got sent. So it's essentially analogous to just figuring out which bits each object sets, and setting all of the union of all of those bits. So for example, if we want to create a bloom filter for P1 and P2, but not 3 or 4, we'll get 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1, 0. Questions so far? Okay, so how do we test for inclusion? We're going to basically check to see whether all of the bits for a particular key got set. So the only way that P1 could be part of the result is if all of the bits that are set in P1's bloom filter are also set in the complete bloom filter that we construct. So we're looking for bit number 2, bit number 4, and bit number 6. And if all 3 of those bits are set, 2, 4, and 6, then 1 we know is part of the bloom filter. Similarly, 3, we test 3 against that bloom filter. So these 2 bits are set in the bloom filter, but this one isn't. So that means we only get 2 of the 3 bits set here. So we know that P3 is not part of the bloom filter. Of course, there's some possibility that you get false positives. So all 3 bits just happen to, by pure accident, be set. So we actually this bloom filter actually identifies P4 mistakenly as being part of the result. Questions? Okay, so we have these 2 parameters that we can juggle, the size of the bit vector and the number of bits that we set per element. So with each of these, we can make the bit vector bigger, we can make it smaller. So what do you think will happen if we make the bit vector bigger? We get fewer false positives. Okay, why would we not want to make it really, really big? So, I mean, the entire point of this exercise is to compress everything. So if the bit vector is taking up a lot more space, then, we're not saving quite as much. But on the other hand, if we make it smaller, we get more false positives. So we want to find a point where the size of the bit vector gives us a good trade-off, a good balance between false positives and the size that we're trying to represent. Okay, we'll get to how we pick a valid M in just a bit. But the other knob that we have to control is the number of bits that we set per object that we want to put into the bit vector. So, what are the trade-offs? Let's say what do we get from putting in more bits? More false positives. Why? So if we pick a very large k, then we end up kind of crowding out the bit vector. With very few elements, the bit vector is going to fill up, and we're not going to be able to reasonably deter. All of the bits are going to be set to one very quickly if you pick k to be too big, and then you're not really getting any information out of it. Everything becomes a false positive. So do we want to make k really small then? So what happens if we pick a very small k? Would it be fair to say that if there's only a few bits that each element says, then there's a good chance that you're going to kind of essentially kind of inverse collisions. The bit vector ends up being very sparse, but every additional bit that you add gives you another kind of chance to avoid a collision. Right? So if I have two bits set, then I need two collisions. Two hash collisions before I run into a problem. If I have one bit set, then one collision is enough to create a false positive. So, if you have more bits, you get more false positives. If you have fewer bits, you get more false positives. So, for k, you kind of want to find this middle ground, where you're not overcrowding the bit vector, but at the same time, you're not risking a chance of a collision on a per element basis. Okay, so how do we pick these two parameters, the size of the bit vector, m and k? So I'm gonna go through a bit of math. This is mostly for just to give you an illustration of how these sorts of things are done. You're not responsible for memorizing this, right? But I want to give you at least a sense of how these sorts of optimizations get performed. So we're going to start off with a very simple example, the case where we have m bits, so just some arbitrary number of bits, and we have a k of 1. In other words, if we have m bits, then the probability that any one of those bits is set by a single hash function, so a single element getting put into our folder, is 1 over m. So if we have one element in our filter, and want to essentially test to see whether that one element collides with a second element. We essentially want to figure out whether that particular bit in the Bloom filter is not set when we go to check. And just by random chance, the random chance probability that you get a collision between two specific elements with one bit is 1 minus 1 over n, or m minus 1 over n. So essentially, okay, so this gives us the probability of two objects colliding in the Bloom filter, two inserted objects just by random chance hitting the same exact element. Sorry, the inverse probability. The probability that we can insert two objects and they won't collide. Okay, so now we want to figure out how to scale this up to k hash functions. So before kind of jumping all the way to k hash functions colliding with k hash functions, yeah, question? This would be n minus 1 over m. So this is, so we have m bits in our hash function. And so far we know, so we've essentially inserted two objects, Alice. Or sorry, we've inserted one object, Alice, with a k of 1. So one of these bits is set. And what we're trying to do right now is figure out whether Bob, with, again, a k of 1, collides with Alice. So we know that one of these bits is set. And the chance, so let's say Bob, let's say that this is the specific bit that Bob's hash function says to use. So the probability that this particular bit is set is 1 over n. There's n possible bits that Alice could have set, and this bit is, there's a 1 over n chance that this is the bit that Alice chose. And it's a symmetric problem. So it doesn't matter if Bob picks this bit or Bob picks this bit, the probability is exactly the same. So the probability that Bob doesn't collide with Alice, that this 1k bit this one particular bit is safe, is 1 minus 1 over n. Does that address your question? Okay. So now let's say Alice sets an arbitrary k bits. We're still testing to see whether one specific bit of Bob's collides with these k bits that Alice sets. Now the hash function is sampled without replacement, so this turns out to be a fairly straightforward. The probability, basically repeats this probability. The probability of Bob not colliding with any of these k bits is the probability that, probability of the disjunction of the possibilities. So in other words, the probability that one bit of Bob's Bloom filter doesn't conflict with all k bits of Alice's Bloom filter is 1 minus 1 over m. Okay, now let's make this a little bit more complicated and say that we're actually, this Bloom filter already contains Alice, Bob, and let's say n additional, yeah.
Alice,
of particulars, Alice used k hash functions. There's some possibility that's essentially sampling with replacement because two hash functions could identify the same person. Does that address your question? What is the concern?
I was thinking that, I guess, if I would put what I said, this would be one that's around, right?
If it was,
there's k bits, I can choose it more, that would be k over.
Yes, so if Alice is setting exactly k bits, that would be k over. But if Alice is setting up to, if every bit that Alice sets is a separate, is an independent decision, which it isn't, it's raising power.
That's the same problem as Alice initially chose one.
Yes. Exactly. It's similar. Yeah. Okay, so we're going to repeat the process, but now we have n objects that we're inserting. So this is, again, a symmetric version of, not symmetric. This is essentially the same exact problem, because now we're picking not k bits, but we're picking n times k bits. Each object is picking, with replacement, k bits, and the objects are okay, so this is the probability that one bit is not set by k hash functions for n records each. So now, what's the probability that all of k's, all of, God, this is my example, look up. So now, what's the probability that all of the k bits that Bob picks are don't overlap with any of the bits that all of the other objects have set? Break this down one step at a time. So the probability that again, looking at just one element, what we have there is the probability that this one bit does not conflict with anything that we've seen so far. Invert that, we get the probability that this one bit does conflict. So we have a definite conflict for this one bit with that probability. We repeat that process k times, and we get the probability that all of the bits conflict. And if we take that, or 1 minus that, we get the probability that none of the bits basically, what that gives us is this handy-dandy formula over here, which tells us the probability that the probability of a conflict. There's some hand-wavy math that gets you to this, but basically, short version is you can basically predict the number of collisions that you're going to get, or the probability of a new record colliding with the existing value with this formula. The interesting feature of this formula is that it doesn't explicitly use n, and it doesn't explicitly use m. It uses the ratio of n to m. In other words, what matters isn't the number of records, and it isn't explicitly the size of the bit vector, it's the ratio of those two. What that basically means is that you can preserve the probability of a collision by linearly increasing the size of the bit vector with the number of records. I'll put that another way. Went and graphed probabilities for different ratios of m to n. But basically, if you use 5 bits per record, then you have, with a k of 3, which is the minimum value, or the most effective k for that size, then you get a probability of collision of about 10%. If you go up to 10 bits per per object that you want to store, the probability of a collision drops down to a bit under 1%. And again, what matters here isn't the absolute number of records, it's the number of bits that you store per record. So this Bloom filter isn't kind of this magical thing that takes an infinite number of records and squeezes them into a tiny box of fixed size. You actually need to scale the Bloom filter, the size of the Bloom filter, with the number of objects that you're storing it. But that being said, 10 bits per object is still considerably smaller than, let's say, a floating point number, which would be 64 bits. You're still talking about a factor of 6 reduction. Similar for long integers. Strings, usually 10 bits, we're talking slightly more than a byte per object. So this is still a fairly significant increase in compression. So recall for k, if you pick k to be too big, the Bloom filter fills up. If you pick k to be too small, you get an increased chance that you need fewer collisions in order to get a false positive. So you can kind of see the curves here. As you decrease k, you get an increased chance of collision. As you increase k, or sorry, the y-axis here is the chance of collision. The x-axis is the choice of k. So as you increase k, the Bloom filter fills up, and you get progressively more of a chance of collision. As you decrease k, then you get essentially the same thing. You need fewer collisions in order to get a false positive. And then there's a bunch of lines here, one for each, one for different ratios. Questions? The last few classes about, so that's basically everything I had to say about Bloom filters. We could, pretty much everything that I have to say about parallel query processing. So before I move on to parallel update processing, are there any questions about anything? There's a standard m over n ratio that you choose. The size of the record doesn't matter. What matters is the ratio of the number of bits to the chance of collision that you're going for. The main trade-off is based on the number of records that node one has. So the absolute number of collisions that you're going to get is proportional to the probability of the collision multiplied by the number of objects that you're going to be testing against. So as the number of objects on the other side increases, you want to increase the size of your pool at the same time. You want to balance that off against the amount of data that you're going to need to send from node 2 to node 1. Could work through the formula, but it's pretty straightforward. There are a bunch of like rules of thumb. If you do a Google search for how big should a pool filter be, you'll get about a dozen different rules of thumb. And most of the systems have their own default set. Most systems that do pool filter. For example, Hive and a lot of the early MapReduce distributed join algorithms did something like that, used filters. I am not entirely sure if Spark uses something similar, Spark doesn't let you do joins directly, but there's things on top of it that do. All right. This might be a good place to do a quick pause. Let's take a break. Be back here at 1:08.
Check the filter, and I'm not sure if I'm going to do that.
Data that you're storing on two so you got a bunch of data that you're storing. And recall earlier in the term, we talked about different things that could possibly go wrong when we were updating data. And kind of the big thing when we were talking about single node operation was non-serializable schedules. In other words, you run, you interleave operations from two different transactions in such a way that the data ends up being messed up. So when we move to a parallel setting and have two different nodes, non-serializable schedules are still there. They don't go away. But now we have a bunch of new problems. So what other types of things could go wrong? So one of the compute nodes, one of the participants, could break. All right, I gave you one for free. What else could go wrong? Also, node one and node two are talking to each other, right? They could become partitioned. You've got your phone wires and a T-Rex can come in and eat that. And there's one other possible thing that could go wrong. Node 1 and Node 2 are talking, but they're also talking to a bunch of other nodes. And if you've got, if each of them are receiving messages, most communications channels don't give you any explicit guarantees about the order in which data arrives if you're talking to more than, between more than three different participants. Messages could arrive just out of order. So just because of proximity, message X might arrive at node 1 before after Y, and at node 2 after before Y. Okay, so the types of things that could go wrong, non-serializable schedules we already talked about, we did that to death. We're not going to look at that anymore because basically all of the stuff that we talked about before still applies here. The problems involving T-Rexes are in some sense the same, and we'll get into why that is in just a moment, but both of them fall under the heading of partitions. And then this problem of delivering messages out of order, solutions to this fall under the heading of what's called consensus. So we're going to focus mostly on partitions today. Time permitting, we'll also get into consensus as well. So again, you've got data organized either by replicating or by partitioning. And let's start out by looking what sorts of impacts these types of problems have when we deal just with replication. So we've got two. So partitions. I said that in some sense the T-Rex related problems are kind of the same. Because from node one's perspective, how do these two different situations differ? They don't. Node one, all node one knows is that it can no longer talk to node two. Node two has fallen off the map. Now, as far as node one knows, node two could still be running or it could be gone. But in both cases, it's just seeing node 2 has stopped talking to it. So this is a big problem because the way that node 1 recovers from this failure, the fact that it can no longer talk to node two. The process that it goes through, or the assumptions that it tries to make, are going to be very different. Because when we recover from that error, one of two things is going to happen. If node two, if it was simply the communication channel that got disrupted, then eventually the channel is going to come back. Eventually, either node two is going to be restarted. Someone's going to come in there and either replace the server box, and node two is going to come back and be able to restart using some of the recovery techniques that we talked about. Or if the channel failure, it's a channel failure, then when node 2 recovers, or when the system recovers, then node 2 is going to have basically the same state that it was at when the failure occurred. And the way that node 1 reacts to each of these cases is going to be slightly different. If there is a if node 2 got taken down, then if node 2 got taken down, then these couple of values that are being stored on both sites end up getting control over them, ends up node 1 no longer has any idea that records now stored both at node 1 and node 2. And we want to make sure that when the system comes back, there's some notion of a consistent state for both of these records. So we start off thinking A is 1, B is 5. And if node 1 thinks that node 2 has been destroyed, then node 1 can basically take over control for all of the data, because node 2 isn't coming back. So if node 1 assumes that node 2 is down, it's basically going to take over control of the system. And now if a user comes along and wants to perform some updates, like, for example, set A to 2, set B to 6, then now A is universally throughout the entire system going to be 2, and throughout the entire system B is going to be 6. And so eventually node 2 might be restarted, reinstalled, or whatever, but node 2 doesn't have, when it restarts, it needs to reconnect to the system, and there's no chance whatsoever that node 2 has its own version of history. On the other hand, this leads to a bit of a problem if node 1's assumption was incorrect. So if the communication channel is what goes down, then node 1 is no longer able to talk to node 2. But node 2 is still there. It still thinks that A is 1 and B is 5. And so when the user comes along and performs the update with node 1, now you have two servers, both still running, both still thinking that their version of reality is correct. So this first strategy, this kind of optimistic strategy, you might think, might call it, where node 1 just takes control over all of the data, runs into the potential problem that you could get inconsistent state throughout the system. The other option is for node 1 to simply wait. So this works very well if there's a communications breakdown. Node 1 and node 2 no longer talk to one another. And now node some user comes along and tries to update the values. And node 1 basically realizes it can't talk to node 2 anymore. So it's basically going to, at this point, start waiting. It's going to lock the transaction until node 2 comes back. And then eventually node 2 comes back, and then node 1 is able to proceed. On the other end, this turns into a bit of a problem, because what if node 2 goes up in flames? Then node 1 gets to wait, and keeps waiting, and it ends up blocking the transaction completely unnecessarily. So essentially, there are two recovery, from node 1's perspective, there's two ways to recover from losing connectivity with node 2. It can assume that node 2 failed. In other words, it'll kind of retain it. The data will still be available. Users can still come in and make modifications to the data. But if it can't talk to node 2, it risks node 2 still being there and creating some inconsistency between its view of the data and node 2's. The other option is to assume that the connection failed, and so it retains consistency. It makes sure that the data is that there are no kind of split realities going on, but that's going to come at the cost of not being able to modify the data while node 2 is down. Anyone seen this before? So this trade-off is often referred to as consistency availability or partition tolerance. Basically, traditionally, you get to pick any two of those, and partition tolerance had better be one of them, otherwise you're not working with a distributed system. In other words, you either never get partitions at all, or you have to give up either consistency or code. All right, questions? All right, so let's get back to consensus. Time to time, you can check copies from different servers so you can get consistency. Not entirely sure. So the observation is that if the channel goes down, you can still have this kind of split reality as long as the nodes are able to come back and work together to resynchronize after the channel comes back up. And that's actually a very good point. The CAP theorem is, in some sense, there have been a number of workarounds that people have come up with. And the underlying problem is, or the underlying challenge is that, talk to node 1, but at the same time, another user might be talking to node 2. So
which one of the new records would be valid when the connection is up?
Exactly.
When we complete the records and for the same time.
Exactly. So there are two updates at the same time, and, or sorry, if there are two updates at the same time, one to each of the different partitioned nodes, then resolving those two records becomes a problem. And most of the solutions or the workarounds operate on one of two basic, take one of two basic approaches. So one approach is to kind of partition the control over the different values. So for example, node one might control A, node two might control B. And as long as you have that, any updates to A, as long as they go to node one, are always going to work because node two knows that it's not allowed to directly update A. The other approach is to use some sort of semantic, some sort of application semantics into the system so that updates are guaranteed to be mergeable. I'll give you a specific example here. Let's say you're talking about, let's say that A is not a number, but it's a set of objects. So A might be the number, the set of people who a shopping cart is a good example. It's the set of items in your shopping cart. So if you're talking about a set of items in your shopping cart, then and the two operator, the one operation that you can perform, this is what Amazon very much like, you can only add items to your shopping cart. You can't, if you want to remove things, you have to create a new shopping cart. So in that setting, if by pure random accident, I decide to talk to node one and add an item to my shopping cart, and then there's some sort of glitch in the system and I accidentally add the same item over here, there's a very clear merge process because two different shopping carts, I can union them together and I get back a new shopping cart that has all of the elements, and there's a very clear process for merging things back together. Any two shopping carts can be merged together and you get back a perfectly valid shopping cart. And the observation there is that any time you have some sort of object or value that's monotonically increasing, or either the number of elements or the set of elements in a set, or an integer that's always going up, timestamps, for example, merging them together is always going to be possible because you always have kind of a least upper bound. There's been some work out of Joe Hellerstein's group. You might have heard of a system called Bloom that talks about essentially using this sort of lattice structure in order to always be able to merge on the scale. So, getting back to the original point, the fundamental problem is merging values together. And the two workarounds are either force your application to give you some semantics for how to merge two conflicting copies together. You've all seen this with Git. I presume you've all had a merge conflict at some point. So that's kind of an example of getting the application to give you merge semantics. In this case, the application is you. Figure out how to merge two different sets of changes. The other approach is to spread out control so that each node is in control of a subset of records. And if, as long as you're talking to the node that controls the record, you're safe. That's a very roundabout way to address your point, but does that address your point? Consensus. All right, so well, we actually just discussed this a little bit. One basic approach to consensus is to have one node responsible for controlling everything. In other words, node one, for example, is responsible for telling you when particular what the order of operations is. Pretty much all of the consensus related problems boil down to picking a specific order for operations. The simplest approach, pick one node to give you a canonical order. And you might hear this described as master-slave replication or primary-secondary replication. Essentially, the idea here is that node 2 always agrees to whatever ordering node 1 gives us. Now, that is a little bit roundabout, that kind of puts a lot of load on node 1, so you can kind of break this down into smaller partitions. Again, we were just talking about this, the idea that node 1 might be the master for A, node 2 might be the master for B, and so messages that arrive pertain to A, the ordering of the messages that apply to A is decided by node 1, and the ordering of the messages that apply to data B is decided by node 2. Questions on this basic model? Great. So this is a nice model, but it leads to a bit of a problem when you want to apply operations that need access to different objects. So if you want to perform a transaction that modifies both A and B, then we need some sort of coordination between these two systems. So for example, I want to withdraw $1,000 from A as the canonical example and transfer that to B. So we talked about serializable schedules. In some sense, this is a generalization of that, because it's not just a matter of picking a schedule of operations to apply. It's actually picking a collaborating, node 1 and node 2 need to collaborate to figure out what the schedule is, what order the operations were applied in the first place. Okay, so there's a couple of different strategies for doing this type of coordination. And the simplest is to pick some sort of coordinator to manage the interactions between A and B. Now, for simplicity, for clarity, I'm going to describe this as a completely separate system, but the coordinator could just as easily be node 1 or node 2. Or it doesn't have to be. So the user goes to the coordinator and says, I'd like to perform some sort of operation on both A and B. I'd like to perform a write on both A and B. So the coordinator is going to reach out to nodes 1 and 2. It's going to maybe receive acknowledgments from both of them. Sorry. Ignore the broken animation there. It's going to receive acknowledgments from both of them, and basically at this point, once both node 1 and node 2 agree on the operation that the coordinator has proposed, then at that point it's basically safe for the coordinator to say, congratulations, your transaction has succeeded. But there's a bunch of things that could potentially go wrong here. talked about T-Rexes, now let's deal with velociraptors. So velociraptor could sneak up and eat one of these packets. So for example, the before the coordinator is able to talk to node 2, the packet might be eaten. So now, presumably at some point, the coordinator is going to decide that node 2 is not responding. Is it safe for the coordinator to abort at this point? And if so, what does it need to do? Okay, so it just needs to tell node 1 that it's aborted. Is that all it needs to do? Great. So from the coordinator's perspective, both of those two cases are the same. The coordinator simply did not receive a response from node 2. In fact, there is no way to even know whether node 2 still exists. Our friendly T-Rex could have dealt with it. So the problem here that we need to address is, when do we know that it's safe to commit? And the solution that's used reasonably commonly in most database settings, or at least for kind of the building up more efficient coordination strategies, the underlying technique, is known as two-phase commit. So the idea of two-phase commit, as before, we're going to pick one of the nodes to be a coordinator, and we're going to refer to all the other sites as subordinates. This one coordinator, we're going to have just one coordinator per transaction, although I'll note that if there are multiple transactions running in the system, there's no requirement that they have the same coordinator. Okay, so again, the challenge here is to come to some sort of agreement between the coordinator, node 1, and node 2 about whether the transaction succeeded or not. So the very first thing the coordinator does is it notifies all of the participants, the subordinates, that there is a transaction happening. Once the nodes are able to apply the operations in the transaction, they're going to send back a message to the coordinator saying, yes, I was successful at applying this operation, or no, I was not successful at applying this operation. Now at this point, each of the nodes, if they say commit, they're going to start detecting conflicts using all of the conflict detection stuff that we talked about as if the transaction had committed. It's not going to finalize everything because there's some possibility that at this point that, say, node 1 sends back a commit message. Node 1 is going to assume, it is basically going to treat transaction 1 as being in the validation stage of optimistic concurrency. So it's basically going to be sitting there. It's going to react to other messages as if it were other transactions, as if the transaction were committed or were going to be committed. But it's not going to actually finalize the transaction. It's not going to complete the commit. The subordinate is also going to locally log the fact that it is in this state, or that it decided to abort the transaction, so that if the node crashes and comes back, it can recover basically up to this point. The coordinator at this point basically needs consensus. It needs all of the nodes to agree that the transaction was able to complete successfully. So if it receives a no, or if it receives an abort from any of the subordinates, then it's going to tell all of the subordinates to abort. And if any of them time out, it's going to do the same thing. If the coordinator confirms that all of the subordinates have committed, then it's going to let all of the subordinates know, congratulations, the transaction committed successfully. So essentially there's two phases going on here. The first phase, the transaction tells the coordinator tells the participants that what the transaction is. And in the second phase, the transaction basically goes back and tells the participants finish the commit or don't finish the commit. And the key thing, the key reason for that round trip is that once a node sends back a yes, once it says that it's going to commit, it's essentially locked all of the resources required by that transaction. So it's at that point, it's safe for all of the nodes to, or for any of the nodes to start committing. It's safe for the coordinator to be able to make a decision because all of the nodes have essentially locked up the resources that the transaction requires, and the transaction. But at the same time, none of the nodes are going to proceed with the, are going to finish the commit, because there's still some possibility that any of the other nodes could try and abort the transaction. Consensus protocols available out there. Two-phase commit is kind of the standard workhorse, but there's a few others. Again, the main challenge is making sure that all of the events are ordered correctly. And the easy way to build consensus is to have all of the operations go through one particular node that either it goes out to the participants and make sure that they agree on an order, or have some other mechanism for creating an order. So so the basic process involves essentially three sets of messages. The coordinator needs to talk to A, needs to tell A what the transaction was, then A responds with a commit, same thing for B. Then the coordinator collects all of the commits and it sends either a commit or an abort. Problem is, the problem is that any of these messages could get dropped, or any of the nodes could fail at any point during this process. So how does the coordinator know that it's able to finish it? Okay, so at this point, it received a bunch of commits, but so let's look at this from the perspective of A and B. There's essentially three phases. There's the phase before. There's the phase where A and B are ready to be locked because the resources, they've committed, but they haven't been notified that that the transaction is done. And then at some point, back and forth messages, at some point you're going to get to if you just take this basic approach, then you end up never just waiting for acknowledgments. One side is always going to be responsible for telling the other one to stop. Essentially, the basic hack is at some point A takes responsibility for communicating with the coordinator. So if instead of waiting for instead of having the coordinator wait for retransmits, A takes responsibility for getting the coordinator to tell them when it can unlock. In other words, if this message gets dropped, rather than putting it on the coordinator to send the messages, put it on A to just keep requesting feedback. All right. Can you put on?